In this video, I'm going to compare the Canon EF-M 11-22 f4 to f5.6 with the Canon EF-S 10-22 f3.5 to f4.5. When I've done these comparisons in the past, I've always found that the newer lens performs better. It doesn't matter if the old lens is an L and the new one isn't, or if the old one was expensive and then the new one was cheap, the new one always performs better. I think the reason for this is because of improvements in lens design and lens coating technology, and also the digital era has had a big effect. With lenses from the pre-digital era, I only ever looked at images on 4x6 prints, and even if the lens had lots of flaws, those flaws wouldn't be noticeable. But nowadays, when we have 20, 30, 40, 50 megapixel sensors and very high quality monitors, any flaw is very noticeable. So because of this, lens manufacturers have really had to up their game. This lens is from 2004, and this one's from 2015. And when I bought this one, I was expecting it to be as good or maybe better than this one. But after doing a few preliminary tests when I first got it, I was really surprised at how much better the images from this one looked. So for quite a long time, I've been meaning to do a more detailed comparison, and that's what I'm going to do in this video. To start with, let's look at some images from that first comparison I did 5 years ago. This is from the EF-M lens, and it looks acceptable, that is, until you compare it to the image from the EF-S lens. This is from the EF-S lens, and when I first saw this image, it really quite shocked me. Just look at how much better the colour saturation is, the contrast, the red and yellow on the steps, the blue in the sky, the green in the grass. It just looks so much better than the EF-M lens. Let's just return quickly to the image from the EF-M lens so you can see what I mean. However, when I did some more comparisons recently, the differences weren't as pronounced. This image was taken with the EF-M lens, and this one was taken with the EF-S lens. And as you can see, there's not a great deal of difference with the colours and contrast. What you will notice is a difference in the focal length. That extra 1mm at the wide end can make quite a lot of difference. This shot was taken with the EF-M lens at the long end, 22mm. And this one was taken with the EF-S lens at the long end, 22mm. As you can see again, there's not a great deal of difference with contrast and colours. I'm not sure how clear it is on the video, but what I can see is quite a lot more sharpness with this lens, and I'll talk more about that in a minute. Here's a cityscape taken with the EF-M lens at the wide end, that's 11mm. And here's the same scene with the EF-S lens. And again, there's not a lot of difference with colours and contrast, but you should be able to notice the difference in focal length between 10mm and 11mm. Here's another one with the EF-M lens at the wide end, 11mm. And here's the same scene taken with the EF-S lens, and the same comments apply. The colours, contrast and sharpness look about the same, and all you can really notice is a bit more width because of the extra millimetre at the wide end. Now let's look at sharpness, and this is the EF-M lens at 22mm, and this image is a crop from the centre of the image. It's not 100% crop, but it is a crop nonetheless. And this is the same thing from the EF-S lens. And although the image from the EF-M lens looks acceptable, when I compare the two, the one from the EF-S lens looks a lot sharper. Again, I'm not quite sure how clear this is on the video, but when I look at my monitor, I can see that this painting has been done with oil, and the oil has a texture, and that texture looks a lot sharper on the image taken with the EF-S lens. Now let's look at corner sharpness, and this is the image I used, and what I did, I just took 100% crop of the teddy bear in the top left hand corner. This is the EF-M lens at 11mm at f8, and the image looks fairly good. However, when we open up the lens to its maximum aperture of f4, there's a noticeable reduction in sharpness. This is the EF-S lens at 10mm at f8, and once again, it's very good. The big difference with this lens is what happens when we open up to its maximum aperture. When we do open up the EF-S lens to its maximum aperture of f3.5, the image remains very sharp, so that maximum aperture is very usable. Whereas with the EF-M, if you can, try to avoid using the maximum aperture to improve your sharpness. A problem with ultra-wide lenses is vignetting. There's such a wide angle of view that the light falls off away from the centre of the image and you tend to get dark corners. I shoot JPEG most of the time and I use the in-camera correction to remove vignetting. If you shoot RAW, you won't be able to use this. The in-camera correction is called peripheral illumination, and in this image I've turned it off so you can get an idea of how much vignetting there is present on the EF-M 11-22mm. It's not a huge problem and it's fairly easy to correct in post-processing. And here's the same thing with the EF-S lens, and straight away you should be able to see the difference in focal length between 10 and 11mm. And regarding the vignetting, it's there, but it's really not too bad. And as I said before, it's quite easy to correct in post-processing. The EF-M lens has image stabilization. The EF-S lens doesn't. With longer lenses, I really want image stabilization. But with these ultra-wide-angle lenses, it doesn't bother me too much. The general rule of thumb is that the slowest shutter speed you can use for hand-holding is the reciprocal of the focal length of the lens. So a 10mm lens on an APS-C camera becomes a 16mm lens, so you should be able to hand-hold at any shutter speed faster than a 16th of a second. And it's not often that I use shutter speeds that are slower than a 16th of a second. This handheld image was taken with the EF-M lens at 0.4 of a second. The centre of the image looks fine, but the monk on the left looks a little bit blurred, which is quite interesting. But to be quite honest, the lack of IS on the EF-S lens has never really bothered me. Of course, the EF-M lens can only be used on EOS M cameras. The EF-S lens can be used on EOS M, and it can be used on DSLRs with APS-C sensors. It can't be used on DSLRs that have full-frame sensors, but it can be used on full-frame mirrorless cameras, such as the EOS R. Now to conclude, and the first point to make, is that this comparison isn't comparing apples with apples. The whole point of EOS M is to have a very small and light system, and it does that fantastically. You can carry around a complete system in a very small and light package. However, you need to remember that you can have anything, but you can't have everything. And if you want a small and light package, you have to compromise somewhere. And that compromise will be image quality. And if you want better image quality, you'll have to carry around bigger and heavier equipment. So it's up to you. What do you want? Owning both of these lenses may seem pointless, but it actually works quite well for me. When I'm traveling with my family, I want the lightest, smallest camera gear possible, and the EF-M lens works really well for me. And let's make this clear, it's not a bad lens. It may not be quite as good image quality wise as the EF-S lens, but it's still a very, very good lens. On those occasions when having the smallest, lightest gear possible isn't the most important thing, and I want a bit more speed or a bit more quality, then I'll take the EF-S lens. If you want more information, I've done individual reviews for both of these lenses. If you like this kind of video, please subscribe to my channel, and thanks for watching.